Good afternoon. Today, as you can tell, I'm with the police chief, and we'll be covering the police department in today's segment of the TV series. Right now, we're outside of the police department. What we're going to first do is walk through the facility. Many people are probably not aware of even what houses a police station inside because they don't like to be on that side of the wall. Then we'll get into discussing what takes place with a normal arrest procedure and also get into operational discussions. And with me is the Chief Gunfriday, who's been police chief for how many years now?
12 years.
And on the force prior to becoming chief?
25.
He was here long before this building. Probably the building wouldn't be here if it hadn't been for him. I'm going to turn the mic over to the chief now as we start doing our walkthrough, and he can explain the significance of each area of the building.
Thanks, Jim. The building was constructed entirely with town funds and completed in 1978. May of 1978, we moved into this building and dedicated it to one of our officers that was killed in the line of duty, Charles Carteret. Ironically, if everybody remembers, in 1978 we had a blizzard, and at that time we were working out of a 45-foot trailer outside the town hall, and that was an experience unto itself. And I'd like to take you on a tour of the building itself. The front entrance of the building, the entry foyer, this wall and the bulletproof partition that was put up this past year had to be erected due to many people attempting to jump over the counter in an effort to go visit some of their friends that we had in the booking area that may have been arrested or for whatever reason, and that's the reason that this wall was erected. At the entry wall to your left is a plaque that was dedicated in the memory of Charles Carteret, who was killed in the line of duty in September of 1967. Charlie was a five-year veteran of the department at the time and was killed at the Workman's Circle during a shootout in the early morning hours. If you'll step in here, this door is a combination lock. Again, that the officers have the combination to. It's a push-button combination that the officers have a combination to discourage anybody from attempting to enter. This area that you see here is the general dispatch center, as we call it. You have two desks here, one of which the secretary sits at. She has a computer terminal that she does word processing, and the officers can do word processing as well. We also were able to do our bookwork, bookkeeping work on the computer. The console where the secretary is now sitting houses all our communications, as well as the computer which stores all our departmental information. Every call that is received is given a number, and it's stored into our computer system for future reference. If you'll move up behind the dispatch center, the console that you see here houses all our radio communications. We have the capability of talking to approximately 25 towns in the Metro West area, as far away as Concord, Westboro, Sherburn, Natick, anybody in the geographical area. The patch board that you're looking at is a collection of patches that the department has been working on for about 4 years, and they come from all over the country and the world. There are some from Tasmania, several from England. The MP patch was donated from an individual who was here on marathon duty a few years ago. We traded him a patch. What we usually do is exchange patch for patch. Some of them are very, very colorful and expensive. The terminal that you're looking at now is the statewide criminal histories system terminal, which allows us to communicate with many state and federal agencies throughout the country to gain whatever information we have to. If, for example, we had to contact the state of Michigan for a records check on an individual, it would just be a matter of going to the keyboard, punching in the information, and probably, if everything is working right, maybe within 30 seconds, we will get a reply back from the state of Michigan as to the criminal history of that particular individual.
But the house number is 160.
Registrations, license checks from all over the country can be obtained through that terminal, put missing persons reports out, wanted people, and so on. This room in here houses our permanent records. This is a part of it. There are five four-drawer file cabinets that house the current record-keeping system of the department. Historically, police departments live on paperwork, but unfortunately, nobody likes to do it. Whenever any officer responds to a call, some type of a report is made out. It's given a file number, whether it be an accident or an arrest number, and it's kept for future reference. All records are kept for a minimum of 7 years. Anything serious is kept for the life of the department. We have records going back 40 or 50 years here. As we walk down the hall, the office on the right is the chief's office. The room on your left houses the, this is our day room, it's a classroom. There's a locker room with 20 lockers, which is already at capacity. We have 20 full-time police officers, four reserves, and we're very slowly running out of space. We also use it as a place to do reports. There is a shower and bathroom in there. Right now we're getting ready for a shift change. The officers are in there changing and getting ready to go. The building has four cells to house prisoners. The two we're going to go into now we refer to as juvenile and female cell blocks. What you see is what you get when you're arrested and placed in one of these cells. You have a one-piece sink and toilet. You have two concrete bunks, and you will get a blanket. There is a sound system in these cells that we can monitor at all times. There is a ventilation system, and we have two of these, and they are used very, very frequently. Part of the new suicide prevention law requires us to check the cells every 15 minutes, which means that the dispatcher on duty has to walk from one end of the building down to the other. He has to walk over to this timestamp. There's a card behind here, and he has to turn this little key to record the time that he came down here, and he has to do that every 15 minutes. According to the new suicide prevention law, the females that we have in here are monitored by female matrons naturally. If we have juveniles, then the officer on duty will have to do that. We generally call individual officers in to babysit, as we call it, because many times the dispatchers cannot leave the desk because of the calls that they're involved with and so on. The room to your right was at one point a interview room. Because of the department's needs, we have modified it. It is also the juvenile officer's room, as well as the interrogation room, or interview room. We've held meetings in here, we've interviewed people in here, and now it serves double purposes. We are now entering the booking area, and when we bring a prisoner in or a person that's been arrested, the first thing that we do is bring him in through the garage area. The garage door is open. A cruiser will drive in. As soon as he's in, the door will close behind him. And the only way out is through the front entrance. We also use the garage as a storage area for bicycles or any other found or abandoned property that we've come in contact with, and we're going to sell at a auction, usually in October. Prisoner is removed from the car. He's brought back into the booking area. Over to the left. In this booking area, he has a seat. Try and make him as comfortable as possible. And the booking process begins. If the individual is brought in for operating under the influence, this machine here is called an Intoxilizer 5000, measures the breath of the alcohol content of the individual that's brought in here. He is given a copy of the results of that particular test. If you can see up here, we have Miranda warnings in Spanish. Everybody has to be advised of many, many rights. 263-5A, driving while intoxicated. A Miranda warning in English. Even though they get copies of all of these things, they have to be posted. And we also have to fingerprint anybody that's brought in for a felony. Print cards are right here, and they're filled out by the officers. Two cards per individual. Paperwork. There are 7 forms that have to be filled out for one operating under the influence. They're all different. They're all separate. There's an arrest report. There's a 263-5A form. There is a refusal form if he should happen to refuse it. There's a form for the court under the new rules we have. His rights forms. There's an operating under the influence report and a notice to the Registry of Motor Vehicles. That does not include the report, the written report that has to be made out detailing the actions of the individual that were involved. If the individual is not being charged with OUI, then many of those forms can be eliminated. The rights forms still have to be given to him. He's booked, he's fingerprinted in here. Photographs are taken. Behind this door here is our dark room. I'd open it for you, but I don't have the key right now. In this room, we have the capability of, it's like a second communications area. We have a radio here. We can communicate with our cruisers out in the road. We have a telephone that also has the 911 lines on it, so that whether it be a business or an emergency call, even though two people may be down here booking an individual, we'll still have communications with them. One of the biggest problems we have is that would leave nobody up in the front dispatch area. That's another reason why we had to erect that security wall. When the individual is being booked out here, is finished being booked here, he is then taken down to his home away from home, which is in here. Now, I have to turn those on. This is the adult male area. There are two cells. What you see is what they get. There is a metal sink and hopper. There is a single bunk. They get a blanket. The new suicide prevention law. It's a plexiglass sheeting over this whole face of the cell block. I don't know if you're going to be able to see me through this, but here I am. It's not a very nice feeling. It's you have to experience it in order to understand what it's like to have your liberty taken away. Literally, there is no place for you to go. The reason the plexiglass was put up was due to the new state law for suicide prevention. The state took the cost of all. We had a new light fixture and sound system put in, and a new ventilation system that had to be put in here. And this was done throughout the Commonwealth. The bars that you see here are solid steel. You wouldn't move them with a stick of dynamite, I don't think. If you look above your shoulder, you will see a camera. From that camera, the desk officer can monitor both cells from up at the dispatch center. But bearing in mind that to your right, you will see the proverbial detex clock, which requires the officer to come down here every 15 minutes and turn this little key to record that he was here every 15 minutes, regardless of the camera system or the audio system that we have in place. All plexiglass. The reason that was installed was to inhibit anybody from doing physical harm to themselves, such as hanging. And unfortunately, shortly after we moved into the station, we did have an incident where an individual did, in fact, take his life from this particular cell, which was not a very nice feeling. Most prisoners that we keep for approximately 4 hours, they're usually eligible for bail unless the crime that they're brought in here on is a very serious one, and which large amounts of bail are required. But most of them, we hope to get out of here in 2 or 3 hours. Most everybody that comes in here for operating under the influence, because of a liability factor, we generally keep for 3 or 4 hours at a minimum until we feel they're safe enough to leave here under their own power.
Now, why don't we go back to your office and we'll just discuss for a few minutes operational makeup of the department and equipment, training, different how shifts work and things of that nature. Now we're in the chief's office. I hope everybody enjoyed the tour of the facility and saw places that we hope none of you have the opportunity to visit. Now I'm just going to ask the chief in the last few minutes of this program to get into the operational aspects of the department and discuss a little bit of history on how the department's grown, how changes in training of police officers taken place, and kind of where it's gone since he was the chief, when it was probably a one-car department and a chief and 3 or 4 officers, to what it is today.
Thanks, Jim. The department has, in fact, grown. When I first came here in 1962, I believe there were 5 men and I was number 6. We had one car, and a second one was purchased, I believe, the following year, 1963. And we used to work one man to the car during the day. At night, in the midnight shift, they doubled up in one car. We had an answering service, if you will. For those of you who are old to the area, the answering service was at the old Kendall Hotel in downtown Framingham. If any calls came in, the answering service would answer the calls, or if anybody happened to be in the station for some reason, we would pick up the call here. They had our radios, they had our telephones down there. So when we left the station, we literally locked it up. That was in 1962. During the course of the next several years, the department started to grow. In 1968, we started a dispatch system through adding officers and hiring some civilian dispatchers. We were able to keep the station open 24 hours a day, and that was a big thing to us. As a matter of fact, one of our first dispatchers was one of your former selectmen, Larry Hunt. Didn't do too bad a job in his younger days. As we went through the intervening years, the town started to grow tremendously, and I was appointed chief in 1975. I came up through the ranks. I was a patrolman from 62 to 1970. From 1970 to 1975, I was a sergeant. And from January of 75, I took over as full-time chief of the department. Since then, things have kind of skyrocketed for us. We have been averaging about one man a year to the department. We are now 20 full-time people, plus a civilian secretary. We have three sergeants, one lieutenant, a chief, and the rest patrolmen. We have four men on a shift. The way we have our shifts configured, we put four people on a shift, one of which is inside as the dispatcher, three are out on the road, and then from 6 to 2 a.m., we have a what we call a cover car that will add a fourth car between 6 and 2 a.m. in the morning, 7 days a week, in order to provide the necessary coverage for the town. Training has changed tremendously. When I first came on, we went to the State Police Academy in Framingham for 6 weeks. We stayed overnight there. Today, the academy requirement is a minimum 12 weeks. They go to an academy, whether it be in Needham, Agawam, or wherever. There are about 12 academies that are available throughout the state. They have a minimum of 480 hours. They receive all kinds of criminal law training, crime scene search techniques, breathalyzer training, or I should say intoxilizer training, defensive driving. They come out as first responders. They're trained in CPR and first aid as a minimum. And then we get them back here on the road. When we get them back here at the department, we put them on the road with somebody for about a week. Because mainly, most of the people that we have hired have come up through our reserve and auxiliary program. We have right now four reserve police officers who are civil service certified, and they would be eligible for the next full-time appointments to the department if they so chose. We have an auxiliary police department of, I believe it's now four men. They have just lost two who just got promoted to the reserve department, so we are looking for auxiliary police. If anybody has an interest in the police field and would like to donate some time and learn about the police field and partake of it, we are more than happy to have you come down and help us out. Once the officers get out of the academy and we have them back here, there are at least three or four of them out on the road at all times. We have the town divided up into sections so that there is a car in various sections of the towns at all time. And hopefully they'll be able to respond to a call within a matter of 3 minutes or 4 minutes at the most, should you need us. What type of calls do they respond to? We're here for everything, from squirrels in fireplaces to sudden deaths or the most serious, a homicide, anything in between. In addition to that, we have two juvenile officers, one of which is on days and one of which is on nights, so that should we have some juvenile problems, one or both of the officers are available to us. They work very, very closely with the schools. Should there be any problems, they're available to help the school or vice versa. We share information very, very much. We have been involved in drug awareness programs at the middle school level and on a small scale at the high school. We have put on many programs dealing with alcohol and do participate with the SAD program. What does the future hold for us? as long as the building continues and people continue to commit crimes, we will have to grow with it. The officers are going to additional training programs in order to keep abreast of the new techniques within the police field. And hopefully we'll be able to continue to serve the town of Ashland in the future as well as we are now. Thank you.
I'd like to thank the chief for his time today, and I hope what people out there as residents of this town will find is a very informative session. People used to going to those town meetings and voting on what actually represents, outside of the school, probably the largest segment of the taxpayers' budget and the town's budget. And I think it's important to know where those dollars are going. I think you've seen today that, they're not purportedly the bad guys. They're the bad guys are the ones who are doing the wrong out there. Their primary role in life is to protect the property and the personal lives of the townspeople and all residents, even people who do not live in this town. And from what I've seen, from personal appearance viewpoint, professional viewpoint, training viewpoint, no matter how you look at this department, it's a department that the town should be proud of. And I hope you will continue to support their needs so that they can better support you as citizens of Ashland. Thank you.
to dedicate this one to Mr. Fafford.
There goes the neighborhood, folks aren't acting like the way they should. Get your bags together, fat man, take the next train for town. There goes the neighborhood, everybody's wondering why the plan's no good. You give a man a little bacon and he thinks he's got the whole thing down. I'm so tired of fat. We knew we were in trouble cause it felt too good. You can't change your minds of people, the people of a one horse town. There goes the neighborhood. We gotta make these folks behave the way they should. I heard a lot of people laughing, so we'd better put a firm hand down. I'm so tired of fighting. Yes, these fools are frightening. And they're gonna pull the whole. Chemical hill, a few contemporaries of it, that ain't a fill. This town is going nowhere, but we gotta take the first thing first. There goes the neighborhood. Folks aren't acting like the way they should. Get your back together, fat man. Take the next train to town. Get your bag together, fat man, and take the next train to town. Get your bag together, fat man, and take the next train. Get your bag together, fat man.
Okay, we're going to try to do something that you might know.
but a song we sing. And fear the way we die. You can make the mountains sing, or make the angels cry. Though the bird is on the wing, and you may not know why. Song I sing, you will understand. Oh, the key to love and fear, it's in your trembling hand. Just one key unlocks them both, it's there at your command.
Thank you.
Thank you. Take the thing about that one. An announcement that Tom Maroney is at the dunking booth. He's probably the driest person in the park, but he's at the dunking booth anyway. Later on, we can all go over to the dunking booth to dry off.
When you wake up in the morning, mouse on the table, see the same old thing, and all food up on the table, and all pork up in a pan. But you better not complain, boys, and I'm playing in a band. Let me not special. Shine a light on me. Let me not special. Shine a light on me, yeah. Well, if you're ever in Ashland, then you better do right. You better not gamble. Well, you better not fight at all. Baby, they'll grab you. You know the boys will bring you down.
Thank you. Yeah.